All right, morning. We're in the electrical bay again. So one of the great things about putting out this stuff on YouTube and just sharing what we're learning is actually learning stuff. And there's a lot of you out there who have way more experience than we do with this stuff or with electricity or with whatever. And we really appreciate that you guys can come in and make suggestions. And some of the things are style things and some of the things are things like that, but a lot of them, they are safety things, and so those we take extremely seriously. So to that point, we're in this bay again because somebody had brought up this past week about these circuit breakers, and so when we bought these, we made sure that we got circuit breakers that are rated for 48 volts because we have a 48 volt system. Like when you buy something that's rated for 12 volts, there's a decent assumption there that the voltage actually going in is going to be around 14.5 volts because that's how things get charged. In order to charge a 12 volt battery, you have to have a much higher voltage coming in so that the voltage will go into the battery. So anyway, we made that assumption with these, and the wording is weird because it didn't say for 48 volt systems, it said max 48 volts. So we thought that was a little weird. The other thing that was weird is we ran across a website because we over research everything, but the website said, even though these say 48 volts, they're not intended for a 48 volt system. So if that's extremely confusing, but it was in big red letters and it was kind of a red flag, but we had already ordered these. So we're like, huh, I wonder, you know, it was one of those nagging things. And so when some comments came through, we actually looked into it and yeah, we were wrong. So that's going to happen. And this being a safety thing, we're going to change it because that's, you know, it's not worth the breakers themselves. You know, we got some comments on those are kind of cheap breakers, but we read there was over 100 reviews on the breakers that we bought, and almost all of them were 4 stars or better, and they are UL listed as well as certified with all the proper licenses and things like that. So we didn't feel that they're a low quality breaker. They were inexpensive, but they weren't cheap. I think they were around 20. They were 20 some dollars each, and then the 200 one was around, I think, 30 some dollars. I'm gonna have to double check those numbers, but they were inexpensive, but they weren't cheap. There's a big difference. So anyway, people were like, look, you should look into the Blue Sea ones because they're actually made for this kind of stuff. They've been doing this for a long time. So we looked into it, and yes, we're gonna go with these Blue Sea breakers here because these guys say 80 volts max DC, and this one here I think it's 65 volts max DC, and that should be plenty because our system should stay under 60 volts even when the battery is charged up to its maximum, absolute maximum, which in order to preserve life, we probably won't do. Each cell can go up to 4.2 volts. We'll probably only charge them to 4.1 just to prolong the battery life and just to keep it safer. So anyway, today we'll be replacing the circuit breakers in there with these. It's going to be a little bit complicated because these are not surface mount. We couldn't find one that was higher than 48 volt in a surface mount. These are called panel mount. So what we'll have to do is make a little panel to kind of stand up off of the board and mount these in. So that's the plan for today. All right, another one of the suggestions that was made was where we bring the power out from our inverter into our box. The wires that are in there are a very thick gauge, so they're 2-gauge cable. And the problem is when we put those in there, they're just really close together. And they're kind of, if they were to wiggle loose, there's kind of a possibility that they might touch. It's a far possibility, but it's definitely worth addressing. So what we're gonna do, and what was kind of suggested in the comments, is to put some blue Loctite on the nut that secures them down, and also to maybe cover the ends just in some thick rubber with a zip tie, which I think is a good idea just in case it comes loose. There's a little bit of added protection there. So that's what we're going to do, is we're going to go in there, Loctite it, and put the little rubber, a little piece of rubber just around it so that it's enough to isolate them from each other. All right, well, it's nighttime again and kids are sleeping. We're out here working. So anyway, we just finished rewiring for the new circuit breakers. So we had to make these little aluminum panels, which was a huge pain. So these took us pretty much all day. So these are mounted to standoffs. So these are then mounted to standoffs just to kind of keep everything in place. So now these will work, you know, just like that. So this is the 200, which goes to our inverter. And he's rated at, I think, 65, and I think these are 80. I don't know, I'll look that up. But anyway, everything is nice and secure here. We use some big lag bolts to attach these, and everything should be free and clear from them. We've got that wired up, and so the one thing left to do in here is to Loctite those two bolts and to tie the rubber thing around them. Fortunately, or unfortunately, whichever you may decide, my little girl's bike had a flat tire, and so we had to get a new tube. So we'll have a little piece of rubber to tie around there. So we'll try that tomorrow. It's pretty late today, so we're gonna do it again in the morning. All right, one last thing. So we heard back from REC, and they said, and I kind of showed them my two contactor system. So this contactor was for the solar panels. The solar panels would come in through here, and then that would be controlled by a relay that's in the REC controller for a battery charger. So I heard back from them, and they said, no, don't do that, because the Victron stuff will control the controller on the solar charge controller to tell it to turn on and off at the appropriate times. And so my original plan was, if we had run out of battery, or if the battery had run down so low, it could still charge from the solar. So even if this contactor, this primary contactor was off, this other contactor would still be on and able to charge the battery, even if that contactor is off. So I talked to them, and they're like, look, that's not a good idea. Just plug it in this way. And so we had to make a new cable, and so we've made this new cable, and now everything goes to this one contactor. So this is the contactor that I got with the BMS. That's the one that they sent me, and that they, it's all set up with the relay and everything to use that one. So we're just going to run it that way. The laptop is almost ready with the software and everything to reconfigure everything. I have a brand new firmware to put on to the REC controller, and that should be able to control all of the Victron stuff. So that includes the inverter, the charge controller, and the color control GX should all be able to read the REC stuff and know the state of charge of the battery, as well as when to turn the solar controller on and off and all that stuff. So they said it all should work perfectly. I just have to flash this other stuff on there. So we're gonna give that a go. All right, so we're working on adjusting the things in our inverter, and that is to kind of put Loctite. So we went and bought some Loctite. Blue Loctite apparently now comes in a red container. So at first I was like, where's the blue? And it says blue even though it's red. Anyway, we're gonna put this on the nuts just to make sure that they stay tight and they don't move around. We're also trying to put a piece of rubber around one of the contacts just in case it breaks loose or it loosens up or anything they accidentally touch, they'll hit the rubber and not metal to metal and cause a big giant short or an arc or a fire or something like that. So anyway, that's what we're up to this morning. It's really crammed in there, so Michelle's mostly in there, and she's using this mirror and a couple of screwdrivers and stuff to try to get the stuff in, but it's pretty tight working in there. Alright, so we have Loctited and put a piece of rubber. So we tried for a long time to get the piece of inner tube to go, but it was just too thin and flimsy and it just wouldn't stay in between. So what we ended up doing is we have this rubber mat that we used to lay down in the water bay, and it's significantly thicker. And what we did is it was just thick enough to wedge right between the two, and then we zip tied it in place with a zip tie around both the cables to just kind of hold it in place in case those things ever let loose or anything like that. But anyway, those cables are so stiff and so, like, they didn't move even when we took the nuts off, so I don't think there's any risk really of them touching. But if they do, we put that piece of rubber in there. But honestly, it didn't feel like the wires were gonna move, but we've done it just in case, you know, just give us peace of mind. So we wanted to thank everyone who's been making comments and suggestions and stuff like that. Super helpful. Most of it we consider all of it, and we can't do everything, but if something's a safety thing and we really feel like we should maybe address it, we go in and do it. So that's what we did here.